Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Eric Holzenberg. I'm the director of the Grolier Club in New York. Some of you in this context may have heard of the name Grolier. If your immediate thought is encyclopedias and the Disney baby books, we are not that Grolier. We are a different Grolier. The Grolier Club is a bibliophile society based in New York City, whose mission is the appreciation, the promotion of appreciation of the book as object. We're a fellowship of men and women, a diverse group. These are tinkers, tailors, soldiers, sailors, doctors, lawyers, you name it. We also have members of the book trade, librarians, but all of these people have as their one consuming passion and interest in the book as object. The book as text, yes, but also the book as artifact, as art object. And we pursue this mission through exhibitions, through the maintenance of a major library on the history of books and printing. I think what sets the Grolier Club apart, though, again, is the passion of its members about books. And our speaker this afternoon, there can be no better example of that mission in action than Glenn Maranker. Glenn provided very thoughtfully a three-page biographical summary, but only three pages, and I think this is an unusual thing for somebody who has accomplished as much as Glenn has accomplished. And the first page is fairly standard. So Glenn graduated summa cum laude from Yale College in 1975 with a bachelor's in computer science. And then he went on to get an MA and a PhD also in computer science at MIT. On graduation, Glenn embarked on a long and distinguished career in with various computer firms, beginning with IBM, and eventually in 1990, signing on with Steve Jobs at Next Computer, and then finally in 1996 at Apple, where he remained and eventually became their chief technology officer for hardware until retiring in 2004. So that is one page. Two pages, single-spaced, is Glenn's activity as a book collector. And it starts with 1976. His wife, Kathy, gives him his first collectible book, an anthology of Sherlock Holmes stories. And the rest, as they say, is history. 1981 gave a lecture, three times in 1981 gave a lecture, 1991 got involved with the Baker Street Irregulars, 2004 joined the board of that organization, delivered a lecture, wrote an article, curated an exhibition, and so on and so on and so on for two further pages, culminating, I may say, in the amazing exhibition now at the Grolier Club, opened in mid-January, of Sherlock Holmes in 221 Objects, which runs through the middle of April. And those of you who can physically be in New York, I hope you'll come by and see it, or it is online in its entirety through www.grolierclub.org. And all of it is a display of amazing and edifying case of obsessive compulsive disorder as embodied in book collecting. That is the Grolier Club's kind of person. And so I give you Glenn Maranker to share a little of that with you this afternoon. Thank you, Glenn.
No, thank you. You can put me up on the screen, please. Ah. So, folks, I have to tell you, this is not a talk I can deliver. I mean, Sherlock Holmes in American popular culture is far too broad a topic to cover in a year, let alone in less than an hour. This phrase I hear of Sherlock everywhere, This is as true today as when Mycroft Holmes first uttered it in the story The Greek Interpreter. For a quick contemporary test of Sherlockian omnipresence, we merely have to consult the Oracle of Google. Google turns up nearly as many references to Sherlock Holmes on the World Wide Web as the New Testament. For whatever that's a fact. What that means, who knows? Amazon lists over 20,000 books not written by Conan Doyle that are about Holmes or in which Holmes makes an appearance. 20,000. With Sherlock's ubiquity, I've puzzled over ways to limit my remarks while still drawing a reasonable picture of the multifarious ways the great detective has informed everyday life from his to ours. So here's what I've decided. I'm going to omit a very large number of things. Consider, for example, Sherlock Holmes stories published in the US for the US market, but in foreign languages. Something we're not going to be able to talk about. But one example in my collection is a Yiddish edition of The Sign of Four, published in 1923 in Brooklyn. Or in the same vein, consider this German language edition of The Hound of the Baskervilles, published in Milwaukee. But we don't have time to deal with foreign language editions. The only book I've been able to find available in more languages than Sherlock Holmes is the Bible. Don Hobbs, the expert on Sherlock Holmes and foreign languages, has found the Sherlockian adventures in 113 tongues. But I'm going to stick to English, and I will also omit a great number of other things. For example, Holmes and science fiction. But to be fair, to give you a feel for the scale of all that we're skipping, I feel compelled as we progress to point out things we have omitted or glossed over. And when I've gone through the things we're omitting and glossing over, and we put that aside, then I'll do my real talk. This image shows Sherlock Holmes the detective enciphered on the Segaba cipher machine, which was used by the US armed forces during World War II. Yes, it is in English, although it's not readable. Throughout the war, there was a need for harmless message text to train crypto gear operators to refine the use of cryptographic systems. For this, the British and Germans often used nursery rhymes. The US Army used Sherlock Holmes stories. And this example is the merest tip of the iceberg of Sherlock in English, yet not in an understandable text. While you could easily argue that this is not really popular culture, it certainly underscores the everywhere in Mycroft's statement. Even in the United States, the canon, which is what Sherlockians call the 60 Sherlock Holmes story, is found in quite a few languages with no need to seek out foreign editions. Can't read this? I assure you it's in English, but it's in Pittman shorthand. In fact, the second Sherlock Holmes story, the novel The Sign of Four, as well as 13 stories of The Return, have been published in Pittman shorthand. During Victorian times, thousands of young men were trained in Pittman both to encourage rapid note-taking, and also writing in this rather obscure script lent a modicum of security to the transcriptions. For brevity, we'll only consider English, Roman alphabet, and non-enciphered occurrences of Sherlock Holmes in popular culture. Another thing that will be not possible for us to consider in any detail because of time constraints, we'll be giving short shrift to Sherlock Holmes in stage plays, radio dramas, movies, and on TV. There's simply too many examples to do them justice here. For example, if we only count major studios, we still get more than 125 movies in English. And on television, we can easily count 200 series. But as we move along, I will summarize that which we are skipping. So for example, the first professional stage production was the four-act play Sherlock Holmes, starring an actor, William Gillette, phenomenally successful and popular in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. The show was very aggressively promoted, and odd as it may seem today, its success was in doubt. We should remember that at the time of the production, 7 years had elapsed since the last Sherlock Holmes short story, and the most recent Holmes novel, The Sign of Four, had been a commercial failure. It sold fewer than 1,000 copies in its first year of publication in the United Kingdom. There were certainly amateur productions before this 1901 professional production. For example, my friend at the Houghton Library, Peter Ricardo, has found an announcement in the Harvard Crimson of April 1894 of a play staged by the Delta Upsilon fraternity in which one of the leads was a disciple of Sherlock Holmes. So even on the stage, Holmes was making this popular appearance even as the ink was drying on Conan Doyle's manuscripts. But there's insufficient time to review Sherlock Holmes on the stage. How about the big screen? Even if I narrow my focus to major new productions that are based at least in part on canonical stories, there would still be far too many to talk about. There's been nearly one production by a major studio each year in English since 1908. But here is the earliest example that I can find. It's a 30-second Nickelodeon film made in 1900, released in 1903. It was made by the first American film company called Mutoscope. It's clearly just a novelty, but it's particularly noteworthy for the special effects used that make crooks magically disappear and reappear. Let's take a look at this. That's the crook stuffing his bag. And here comes Sherlock. Boom. Where'd he go? Darn. He's back. No explanation, but... And he disappears again. Holmes takes the bag of pelf, hands it to somebody off stage, and magically, you can't quite see it, the crook appears with his bag on the other side of the stage and out the window. So, 1900. This fellow who played Sherlock, unnamed, likely just one of the stage hands, somebody that just grabbed. But it's truly amazing. Holmes makes this appearance on the screen 5 years after moving picture projectors became commercially available. Let's see. We're fast-forwarding through cinematic history, which means I can't pause to talk about the actors whose portrayal of Sherlock on stage and screen is all but iconic. But in the spirit of being absolutely clear about what I'm omitting before I get to my talk, I'll show you a few of them. Some may surprise you. We spoke about William Gillette, first Holmes on the professional stage, and he had another first, Gillette made the first Sherlockian radio broadcast in the United States in 1930. Ellie Norwood made the first silent movie based on an actual Sherlock Holmes story, and from 1920, to 1923, he did a total of 47 Sherlock Holmes films, all of which were commercially successful. The sire of the Barrymore Empire played Sherlock Holmes in 1922. Knowing that we're going to run out of time, let me quick go through that. Clive Brook in 1931 did the first canonical Holmes talkie, barely 2 years after the jazz singer in 1931. And of course, we all know Basil Rathbone, made a total in Hollywood's golden era, and he made a total of 13 films as Sherlock Holmes. Let me skip past that. And then we have Jeremy Brett, who in my opinion is the most definitive portrayer of Sherlock. In 1984, he started the first of a series of canonical stories. The intent, the plan, was to do the entire canon of 60 tales, but they only completed 41 episodes before his untimely death in 1995. The popular appetite for films of Sherlockian stories far outstripped what this lineup of stars could provide. There were many, many more. In 1893, there was Charles Brookfield, and then Maurice Costello in 1905, who was the grandfather of John Barrymore. And then a bunch, many of these will be familiar, some of them will be surprising. Yeah, I showed them with Deerstalkers and a Sherlock Holmes pipe to make sure you believe me. So I was able to do a quick piece of research using IM database and the Broadway database, and I was able to count 340 actors who have played Sherlock Holmes. So it has to be more. On those two databases, there were 340. Now, for every actor who has played Sherlock Holmes, there are a dozen others who have paid homage to him in their roles, adopting characteristics we revere in Holmes in their roles. Here's a few of the actors and comedy teams who have played fast and loose with the great detective's deductive powers. Our friend on the Sherlock Holmes Baffled, whose name is lost. Vaudevillian Sam Pozlowski did a silent film in 1912, Sherlock and Sleeping Beauty. Yeah, all right. Lloyd Hamilton played a half a dozen roles as Sherlock Bonehead. Many of us, I think, have seen the Buster Keaton movie, The Detective, in 1924, where he plays Sherlock Jr.
Is this movie like original screenplays?
These are movies.
Yes.
No, these have nothing to do with the canonical story. Well, they may have the occasional reference to them, but these are non-canonical. I suspect not so many of us have seen Jimmy Durante in Speakeasy, a completely forgettable movie, Don't Bother. But one of my favorite movies is this now fairly obscure detective piece from 1935. It's riddled with Sherlockian references, and for me it's doubly pleasing that it has William Powell as the detective. This harkens back to Powell's first movie role in the 1922 silent film, Sherlock Holmes. Let's take a look at a few clips from Star of Midnight with Powell and Ginger Rogers.
Although a week has elapsed since the murder, Inspector Doremus, in charge of the investigation, refused to make any statement other than the customary one that the police are investigating the case. Clay Sherlock Holmes Dalzell is just about as gabby as the inspector. His assistant, Dr. Donna Watson Manton, is completely in the dark as to his plans.
All right, Watson, come out.
Well, what detained you?
You don't mind, Mr. Dalzell. We got a couple of questions we'd like to ask the maid.
Go right ahead. We're just leaving. Come, Donna.
Goodbye, Inspector.
Goodbye.
What do you make of all of this, Mr. Holmes?
Hey, I told you there was something phony about this. Why did she call him Mr. Holmes?
So there were plenty of films where Sherlock Holmes was used as a, shall we say, departure point. 1939, Edgar Bergen and Charlie McCarthy made a movie called The Detective. I have to say Edgar Bergen is really near the top of my list of world's luckiest people. A ventriloquist who makes his money on the radio. I just... But, you know, what can I say? Of course, the Three Stooges got into the deducting business. Bob Hope, 1947, in search of a woman, you know, donned the hat and grabbed the pipe. And another clip from 1951. Pardon me, I pressed the wrong button. Whew. Ah, well, other actors who have imitated, acted like whatever Holmes, include George C. Scott, they might be giants in the 60s and 70s. John Cleese, The End of Civilization as We Know It. And Patrick McNee, I think he's probably more familiar, at least to some of them, us in the Avengers as Steed, but he also played Holmes. Of course, Disney gets into the act, the 1986, The Great Mouse Detective. And then there is this wonderful movie called Sherlock Undercover, who has gotten my favorite film review ever. Quote, making a movie like this one should not be legal. And Brent Spiner, of course, actually in several episodes took turns as Sherlock on Star Trek The Next Generation. But this still only gets us up to the 1990s. Let's turn to more recent television. It's safe to say that TV forensic experts and cops are virtually channeling Sherlock Holmes. The series House, one of my favorites, now, he's rather damaged, though gifted internist. Not a detective, you say? Just a doctor? Not related to Sherlock Holmes? Don't underestimate Holmes' influence on pop culture. Consider this. Dr. James Wilson, similar to John Watson, is his best friend. House lives in apartment 221B. He's unapologetically addicted to Vicodin, just as Sherlock had problems with cocaine. House was shot by Jack Moriarty. You may remember that Sherlock Holmes' nemesis was Professor James Moriarty. Irene Adler is House's imaginary love interest. A second edition of Conan Doyle was a Christmas gift to House in the episode It's a Wonderful Lie. And a book by Joseph Bell, who was Arthur Conan Doyle's instructor in med school and who gave an awful lot of Conan Doyle's ideas to embody in the character of Holmes. A book by Bell was House's Christmas gift in Joy to the World. And what about other, shall we say, situationals? The executive producer of CSI, Carol Mendelson, describes her character, Grissom, as Sherlock Holmes in a lab coat. in Law and Order Criminal Intent, Renee Balker, aiming for a sexier, hipper version of Conan Doyle's detective, came up with what he calls a cross between Sherlock Holmes and Bob Dylan. Now, Monk, Andy Breckman, head writer for the show Monk, says outright that he did more than borrow a bit from Conan Doyle in fleshing out the show's detective hero. It's almost as if I used a Xerox machine. In fact, he says, all three of the show's main characters are lifted straight out of Doyle. Let's take a quick look at Sherlock Monk and Sharona Watson.
What's he doing?
I love this part. He does this Zen Sherlock Holmes thing.
Zen Sherlock Holmes, huh?
Excuse my language.
It's okay, Luchuk.
It's unbelievable.
You solved it.
You did it. You don't even know these people, and you solved the case. It's like when I used to read Sherlock Holmes to you. You'd figure it out by page two. Well, what about the proof?
This truck is the proof. It's all the evidence we need.
So in the interest of keeping the schedule, keeping the time, I won't be showing you Lisa Simpson donning a cape and deerstalkers to solve the mutton chop murder, or Hawkeye Pierce doing a turn as Sherlock Holmes in an early episode of MASH. We will entirely skip Johnny Lee Miller and Lucy Liu in CBS's Elementary. But a show that just started two weeks ago, I think deserves a mention. Jack Reacher, the popular action hero hatched by the British writer Lee Child. Reacher books have collectively sold more than 100 million copies worldwide. A gigantic, imposing man, but does he borrow from Holmes? Let's take a look at the first episode of this new show.
Maybe I'll cut a deal and talk.
Maybe I'm just thinking the guy who was seen near the murder site, guilty or not, might still have information to share.
I don't, but Stevenson does. He and Hubble were looking at each other.
They looked at each other.
They held eye contact for a full two Mississippi.
Stevenson and Hubble have cousins that married each other. He's just worried about family.
It's more than that.
You're always so confident in your theories.
As confident as I am that you went to Harvard, you recently divorced, and you quit smoking in the last 6 months.
How'd you come up with that?
My friend back there, Baker, he called you a Beantown bitch. And from all appearances, you're well educated, but you took a job in the middle of nowhere with people that look nothing like you. You're stubborn, you have a chip on your shoulder, you don't care if your coworkers like you. A guy like that doesn't go to BU, he goes to Harvard. To show those blue-blood assholes what he's capable of, am I right?
About going to Harvard? Yes.
You're also about 40, which means you did your 20 at Boston PD to get your pension so you can afford a proper Southern suit, but you still look like Black Sherlock Holmes. It means no woman in your life making sure you dress right. Death or divorce, at your age, divorce is a higher probability, but you still wear the ring. By the wear on, you play with it, obsess over it. Like I said, you're stubborn. Still hoping to reconcile with the old lady.
Her name's Sharon.
As for the smoking, when I broke down the three murderers back there, you started to think you had the wrong guy. It stressed you out. The water in your glass moved a bit. We're not on any major fault lines. It means your leg was bouncing under the table. That combined with the slight aroma of cigarettes in your suit, because it's hard to get out of tweed. And I assume nicotine withdrawal. Well, the studies show it takes 4 to 6 months to fully break a habit. You keep up the good work, though. Those things are killers.
Back inside.
So I hope you're okay with these many omissions. Let's continue reviewing instances of Sherlock Holmes in popular culture that I must skip. Sherlock Holmes' presence in everyday commerce, just briefly. The great detective has been co-opted by advertising to lend cachet to products for well over 100 years. His judgment and insight have been used to tout everything from rubber-heeled boots to Nestle's coffee and cocoa, Saxon matches, railroad freight services. Holmes can certainly tell you the best raincoat to keep you dry. And what about if you're on the lookout for a nice crisp pickle? Who would even contemplate thinking of prospecting for uranium without the great detective? And even Tuck's enemas, which I share with you without comment. Even Coke and Pepsi agree that Sherlock Holmes is the one to consult when you want a soft drink. Holmes will help you with head lice problems. Or, does your dog have allergies? He can help you find the solution. Are you in a quandary about which metal detector to buy? This is the one Sherlock Holmes recommends. And in these vexed financial times, Sherlock Holmes and Warren Buffett will help us forward. These commercial areas have made three commercial areas have made particularly intense use of Holmes. Tobacco companies forged one of the earliest and perhaps most enduring commercial tie-ins with Holmes. This is an advertisement from 1915 for Varsity Tobacco. As you can probably guess, I have to omit this chapter of social history again because of the time constraints. But I do feel duty bound to give you a little taste of what we're skipping, especially as most of you know, Holmes made a particular study of tobacco ash and was able to identify 140 different kinds of pipes, cigars, and cigarettes from their ash. And Holmes himself smoked more than 250 times in the canon. So Holmes certainly indulged in the evil weed, and tobacco companies took advantage of this. Consider tobacco cards. Originally, these cards were blank and merely utilitarian, nothing more than stiffeners to protect the cigarettes in their packets. But by 1886, they'd been transformed into advertising space, and they fast became collectibles. What's been called the golden age of tobacco cards, 1900 to 1917, there were more than 150 US and British cigarette manufacturers issuing some 1,800 different card sets. The number of cards in a set varied widely from 25 cards was typical, but some had as many as 200. Collecting contests abounded, and some even took advantage of Conan Doyle's fame. I know of some 200 cards that feature Sherlock Holmes, but in the interest of time, let's just look at a couple. Here's a series of cards that used our friend William Gillette's image to help promote their tobacco products. And of course, why not? Why not also use Conan Doyle? The real glory days of Sherlockian cigarette cards was around 1923. In particular, that's when a tobacco company, the Bugoslavsky House, released a series of 25 cigarette cards. We had Sherlock, little bio on the verso, Sherlock in disguise, Inspector Lestrade, Holmes's frequent foil in Scotland Yard. Of course, Watson, and Violet Hunter, one of the women whose age Sherlock Holmes went to her aid. The whole set is 25 cards. Though cigarettes began to overtake cigars and pipes thanks to the invention of a machine cigarette roller in 1881, most of you probably have a clear image of Sherlock indulging in all forms of smoking tobacco. And so, of course, cigar manufacturers also capitalized on the connection. There was a cigar called Sherlock Holmes Crooks. This is an example of the inner label in a box of Crooks. We're crazy collectors. It occurs in several variants. The cigars themselves come in two different cigar bands, a brown one and a gold one. And then cigar boxes had what was called an outer label, and that was put over the very plain cigar box because they were just not very striking otherwise. So here's an outer label. Here's another outer label looking like fake wood. Another outer label. And again, we see our friend William Gillette shown both as an actor and acting as Sherlock Holmes. Of course, the opportunity for a movie tie-in was not to be missed. The same tobacco company put out the same cigar, calling it the Sherlock Jr. cigar, right on the heels of the Buster Keaton movie Sherlock Jr. Again, these are some example inner labels from those cigars. There were also pipe and chewing tobacco containers that used Holmes for a promotion. Gallagher's Honeydew, quite popular. Or what about a meerschaum pipe, where the bowl was carved in the appearance of Sherlock Holmes. Peterson's Sherlock Holmes pipe tobacco. Shag tobacco for pipe smokers in the convenient pocket size, or for your smoking table in the jumbo size. And we're gonna skip the backstory of this advertisement because we just don't have time. Many other products have capitalized on Sherlock Holmes' integrity and prowess at reasoning in their ads. He symbolized accuracy and reliability for assurance funds, vehicle recovery, home inspection, how to save water, home heating, home security and property insurance, lost persons location, and even remote gas imaging for any of you who are fracking or perhaps operating petroleum cracking plants. Automotive products extensively used Holmes to promote their stuff. The earliest I've found is this Sherlock the Electric Detective. It was made in 1912. And to put that in perspective, the first Model T was 1908. It's for checking electrical systems. The thermoscope is likely from the mid-20s when Atwater Kent, the radio giant, was still producing automotive products. And then we have the Hastings compression tester. I think you can see Sherlock with his magnifying glass and hat in the center of that gauge. And it goes on and on and on and on. Bearings, electrical systems, ignition systems, fan belts, cars themselves. But for our last automotive product, a current day compression tester, relying on Holmes' credibility for some cachet. Let's consider something a little more playful now. Perhaps games. The earliest Sherlock Holmes game I've discovered is this stick figure puzzle on the back of a 1900 cigarette card. The object was to arrange 10 matches in 5 rows of 4. The first widely popular game that capitalized on Sherlock Holmes' intellectual skills was the Parker Brothers game of Sherlock Holmes, first produced in 1904. This game was in production until the mid-20s. occurring in an unimaginable number of different boxes, cards with different backs, although the game remained the same. These are just a few representative sets of this game. Later on, there were two broad trends that emerged on the Sherlock Holmes games front: mystery solving and role playing. Bringing Sherlock home was finding a missing person board game, 1937, we have Mr. Whiskers. You have to solve a jewel robbery. It's intended as a party game. But Holmes hit board game big time with Clue. Clue was invented during World War II by Mr. and Mrs. Anthony Pratt of Leeds as a way to pass the time while they were huddled in their Anderson's shelter. It was copyrighted in 1944, but it wasn't produced until 1949 due to material shortages. Then it was pretty much simultaneously published by Waddington's in the UK and Parker Brothers in the US. It got a spiffing up in 1980 by Waddington's to Cluedo. And there are other board games. They're again, probably not countable. And of course, Disney, of course, gets into the act, cashing in on Holmes' appeal with this game, which has absolutely nothing to do with Sherlock Holmes, but helps sell games, huh? The cap and the magnifying glass, but the game itself, nothing to do with Sherlock. There are also some learning games. 1930 saw this G-Man official fingerprint set. The sales were very disappointing at first, but it was pretty quickly reissued 2 years later with Sherlock Holmes properly featured. Then again in 35, and then again in 38. Simple manipulative games, taking advantage of the Sherlock Holmes image, also abounded. Here's a 1947, basically it's a version of Tangrams. Find the Lady is just a packaged version of the three-card Monte Confidence game. And what this one has to do with Sherlock beats the heck out of me. Balloon modeling with Sherlock Holmes? It's not... Now, unless you think Sherlock Holmes is passé in games, just consider these computer games. A quick search shows 200 different titles. The PC, for game platforms, and so forth. I think I'm... Well, I was... I finished telling you what we weren't going to talk about, and I was going to start at this point and actually talk about Sherlock Holmes and popular culture, but I guess we won't have time. I've used up my time slot with the preamble and no time left for the actual talk. But I really think I had a good talk prepared for today. Well, let me just close then by saying Sherlock is certainly part of the zeitgeist of today. There's a crater named for him, and in fact, it figured in the science news. A couple of this crater, well, one of the Mars rovers went near it. Holmes is everywhere. He's left his mark on our culture, starting with his appearance 1887 until today. We take a look at the Urban Dictionary. We have the phrase, elementary, my dear Watson, thoroughly ubiquitous misquote. Holmes actually never says that. And other things which polite company will not mention. You've certainly heard among high school students doing some online Sherlock Holmes action means a web search. In fact, in spite of my best efforts, I was only able to find five things not touched by Sherlock Holmes. Baseball, football, NASCAR racing, fly fishing, and I thought rap music, but about a month ago, somebody sent me a video of a rap of Sherlock Holmes battling with Batman. At any rate, in the interest of leaving a little time for questions, let me end it here.
Thank you, Glenn. That was delightful. So yes, we do have time for some questions now. Because we are recording and we're live streaming, we have Tina with a microphone. And raise your hand, please, and speak into the microphone so that the question gets recorded as well as Glenn's answer.
Just a quick question. Would you mind speaking about the outfit that was more associated with the movies than the actual books? Or what's your take on that?
Well, there are a number of things which we are profoundly associated with Sherlock Holmes, which actually do not appear in the stories. So, for example, in the stories, he never smokes a meerschaum pipe. William Gillette, our friend who did that play which opened in 1899, actually wrote to Conan Doyle, letters extant in the British Library. To ask him some questions. And one of the questions was, would it be okay if he smoked a scooped, bowled meerschaum pipe, even though it doesn't appear in the stories, because he found it particularly convenient to handle and deliver his lines with that kind of pipe. Similarly, the deerstalker, the Sherlock Holmes hat, does not appear in any of the stories. There are cloth caps, there are hunting caps that are suggestive, but does not appear in the story. So those are just two examples. So a lot of our mental picture of Holmes actually comes from early dramatic productions.
Gentleman in the back.
To what do you attribute the popularity of Sherlock Holmes and the longevity?
It certainly is remarkable. You know, Sherlock has been around for over 150 years. And, you know, even today, there are three TV shows that current running. There's another Robert Downey Jr. movie in production. I think that there's something magical about Conan Doyle's writing that transports me back to a time which feels very comfortable and very familiar for God only knows what reason. I mean, there's not a drop of English blood in me. I know I've never lived in London. I certainly haven't lived during Victorian time, but it all feels familiar and comfortable. I also think that I find that more apt description of the Sherlock Holmes stories, it's more like fairy tales than crime fiction. That is, you have these mythic figures of good and evil. There's this character, Sherlock Holmes, who can simply do, he's human, but he can simply do things that you and I can't. And I think all these things result in his in the longevity. That's my theory, I'm sticking to it.
Hi, sorry. So you mentioning the rap battle between Sherlock Holmes and Batman reminded me of a trend I've seen and among some comic critics of something called the Sherlockification of Batman, where there's a move away from his like camp focus or the grand good and evil element and more focus on the detectiveness. But that has me wondering, do you know anything about the legacy, or does it exist, of Sherlock Holmes in comics or graphic novels and kind of the visual book form as opposed to the text?
Oh, there are definitely graphic novels and comics of Sherlock Holmes, for sure. I'm suddenly blocking on the authors of the Sherlock Holmes graphic novels. It's not something I particularly enjoy, so it's not something I pay very close attention to. But I have seen, for example, gothic novels. And my attitude about these sorts of things is that there's some that I like, most that I like, some that I don't like, but anything that keeps the memory of the master green is good.
Did Conan Doyle benefit from any of this popular culture of Sherlock Holmes? Did he have any intellectual property protections at all?
The short answer is I don't know. I have posed that to some knowledgeable people. I'm working with two, actually they call themselves Holmesians in England, which is, technically it's a little more correct. If you think about the stories, Sherlock is never called Sherlock, he always is called Holmes. But looking into Conan Doyle's finances. Some of it is pretty easy to chase down, how much he was paid for various stories. But things like he was a terrible, terrible, terrible investor and lost lots of money on stupid investments. But what he got from these commercial things, we haven't found any information yet. So just don't know.
Yeah, again, so who owns the image to Sherlock Holmes today? Is that, am I just asking that question again or what?
Oh, whose image is most evocative of Sherlock Holmes today?
No, who owns Sherlock Holmes' image?
Oh, that's a good
the
question.
The rights to his image, that's what I'm saying.
That's a good question. I don't know. Oh. I do know it has been established all the stories are now in the public domain. The last two slipped into the public domain. There were a fair number of court cases where the estate took people to task for using the character. And that eventually, one of the fellows that they threatened, a guy named Les Klinger, took them all the way to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court said, no, if you're literally using the text of the stories and those stories are still stories in copyright, that's a violation. But the character, the ethos, all that is not protected. So that's been decided. I don't know if that extends to images. It certainly extends to the stories and characters and so on and so forth.
Advertisement, that is an intellectual property, I would think.
But the interesting point, I guess, is that the text is a description of Holmes.
Yes.
But the image that we see is the interpretation of an artist, a completely different person, and a completely different kind of artwork.
Yes.
Yeah, this is arguable.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm hardly an expert on copyright and trademark issues at all. So I really don't know the direct answer. I do know that taking advantage of the characters and so has been decided by the U.S. Supreme Court and says, no, it's not protected. In fact, I forget which judge, but one of the judges, they can write these side opinions, and he agreed with the overall thing, but he said almost directly in these words, the estate is clearly just blackmailing people who are afraid to go to court. In particular, Hollywood is very loath to take these things to court even though they've been decided and decided in what would be in their favor.
Question here.
Yes. Is there a backstory to his appearance in Beaton's Christmas Annual, or is it just that's who he submitted it to?
Well, the story is that Conan Doyle wrote this novella, and worked for a year to try and place it, and got no nibbles. And finally, Wardlock said, "We will take it, but you're going to sell us all rights for £25." And we're going to use it as a piece in next year's Christmas annual. There was a very popular cooking magazine in mid-Victorian times called Mrs. Beaton's Cooking Manual, and they put out a special edition each Christmas. And one of the features of the special edition was highly touted on the cover of the Christmas issues, contains an original piece of literature. And so in 1887, the original piece of literature was the story. Conan Doyle tried for a substantial part of the rest of his life to buy back those copyrights, and Wardlock would just not part with it.
Please talk into the microphone. Thanks.
This sounds like a dumb question, but I take it that Holmes was a character, not a real person.
Well, it depends on who you ask.
Oh, and the reason why I ask is you don't hear anything about his family. There's no bio or background. I mean,
well, there have been in the scholarly literature. There are a handful of references in the story.
Okay.
That, in fact, on Holmes's mother's side came from France, and included some artists. And his brother, Mycroft, certainly appears in three stories. Not extensively, but in three stories. And there is an interesting amount of scholarly research to piece together Sherlock Holmes's bio. I mean, we know he went to college. Huge debates on whether it was Cambridge or Oxford. We know he has some medical training. I mean, Watson encounters him for the first time in a lab working on a blood test. So we know some things about him.
He's a real person, okay.
But it's fragmentary.
Mm-hmm. I see. Thank you.
I believe we have time for one more. One more question? All right, excellent. If not, thank you again, Glenn.
Thank you.